Now, to deliver the first keynote speech for the day, we have a great scientist in our midst. He was a senior official at the ISRO in charge of the cryogenic division. He introduced the liquid fuel rocket technology in India in the 1970s.
After working for nearly two decades, his team developed the Vikas engine, which is used by several ISRO rockets, including the PSLV that took Chandrayaan 1 to the moon in 2008. A very charismatic personality. It is a great honor in having you with us today, sir. May I request Sri S. Nambi Narayanan to please join us on the stage to deliver the keynote address.
Good morning, everybody. I'm sorry, I don't know the names of most of the dignitaries sitting here because it was a short notice and I accepted to be with you. So honestly, I didn't have much time to prepare for this event. So I thought I'll just share with you what is relevant and what is my experience in ISRO. Just a brief background information. I graduated in mechanical engineering, and then I studied in Princeton, USA. I specialized in combustion instability, worked for NASA, and about 30, 35 years of experience in ISRO. My major contribution is the liquid propulsion systems in India, with a special reference to the Vikas engine, which is propelling the PSLV and GSLV. Of course, I asked the first project director for the cryogenic engine, which was later completed and carries the Mark III, which is a version of geosynchronous satellites into orbit. So when PMI comes in the picture, maybe you will be addressing four projects which are varying between railway tracks to highways to irrigations to power projects, nuclear and whatnot. But my specific experience and exposure is primarily on aerospace. So I would like to share with you in the aerospace area what my experiences are. Actually, all through my career, I was primarily a project manager or project director, whatever you want to call it. Of course, after all, a project director has a job for on a defined product with an acceptable timeline and deliver the product within the cost stipulated. This is primarily the job of a project director. And I think PMI is probably closely associated in ensuring what ways to do and what not to do in terms of meeting that goal. Now, I'm going to take about 25 minutes, which was given to me as my available time budget. And primarily, I am going to touch upon, as I said, from my own experience, what are the successful projects we had in ISRO, and what are the failures we also experienced in ISRO, and what is our management plan? What was our management plan? Okay. So I was fortunate to be associated with ISRO right from 1966, when the strength of ISRO was only 23 engineers. And today we have a strength of close to 28,000 engineers. So the span of time with which we grew was very high. I had the luck of working with three legends of ISRO, rather I should say four. One is Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. Another one was Professor Satish Dhawan. And third one was Professor U.R. Rao. And finally, but the most important person was Dr. Kalam. And I should also recall and share my own experiences with Kalam. That was beginning. We used to share a table, common table. We were about some five people, myself, Kalam, C.R. Satya, Majid, and Sudhakar. So that is how we started our career. And during this time frame, ISRO actually had developed its own management techniques, borrowed from some of the management techniques which are documented, but some developed by ourselves. I'm going to share particularly those techniques which we developed ourselves and got with success or burned our fingers, either way. So in that, just to give you a brief background of who was Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, whom you all know well, that he was our chairman Atomic Energy Commission as well as chairman ISRO, when ISRO, as an ISRO didn't exist at that time. During 66, late 60s, he had the vision of a very unimaginable, or it's not easy for any one of us to understand. Like, he could get the Russians by contributing their Minsk computer and their M-15 helicopter, and the Americans to contribute the Nike Apache rockets, and the French to contribute the Centaur rocket as well as the PVC propellant plant, and above all, the Japanese to contribute on the consultancy. Imagine the wide spectrum. He was able to put all the forces together. At that time, it is extremely difficult or even unimaginable to think of Americans and Russians coming together. But he made use of the geographical advantage of Tumba, which is a small, tiny fishing village in the southern part of Kerala, close to Earth's magnetic equator, and then said that here he is going to establish a launching station, which is shortly known as TERLS, Tumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Station. And he made all the, incidentally, he dedicated this station to the UN, United Nations, but by none other than the Prime Minister of India at that time, Mrs. Indira Gandhi. And he was the one who initiated the space-related work in India. A great leader with great vision. Here, I am listening to people talking about the leadership qualities. Actually, if I have to name some of the leaders, these are the four names who will come as the great leaders in the scientific field of India. And number one is Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. I told you about his greatness, and he was visualizing not only the sounding rockets and the experiments associated with high altitude, but also was visualizing making rockets, particularly small size. And of course, during his time frame, he visualized the project called SLV-3. If you expand it, it is Satellite Launch Vehicle 3. So which would mean that there were other options, namely SLV-1 and SLV-2. And both were never realized. It is something like Kalam's project. When I was working with Kalam, just to recall, he had a project by name D1. So when I asked him, what do you mean by D1? Is there projects like A, B, C, etc.? He said, no, the D denotes dreamer. So the word dream, actually, which he used very popularly when he became the president, telling the younger generations, you dream. The dream came to him even during 1966 period itself. So he has named his first project as a dreamer. And incidentally, that was only in dream because it didn't come through. It didn't come through because of various technical problems. But coming back to Dr. Sarabhai, now Dr. Sarabhai is the one who visualized SLV-3. And SLV-3 was the first successful rocket flown by India, headed by Kalam, during 1979. But unfortunately, Dr. Sarabhai was not alive. And he died, I think, 30th December 1971 in a so-called castle there in Kovalam. Now we are discussing with whom we should share that castle, not even thinking of making a memorial out of that palace. And that is the place where he died. And of course, story goes that we didn't do, and he was only 51 and healthy. I was fortunate, as I told you, to closely work with him. I'll come back later, some of my experiences with him. But he didn't have any known diseases like pressure, cholesterol, or all kinds of things. But he died. And nobody knew why he died. It continues to be a mystery. And that is Dr. Sarabhai's starting point. After Sarabhai died, it was taken over by, for a short period, by Professor Menon, and then subsequently by Dr. Satish Dhawan, who is also a great leader. Now, incidentally, Dr. Sarabhai was heading the mission for about 5 years. Not 5 years, 7 years. And then Dr. Dhawan was heading it for a period of 12 years. So you will notice, subsequently, Professor Rao was heading it for again 12 years, 10, 11 years. You will notice in ISRO, which I'm sure you will agree with me, is one of the great success stories of ISRO, India. The head of the mission was having a long tenure, contrary to the other service heads, where the serviceman changes once in 2 years or 3 years. So certain projects go by his knowledge, or put it loosely, his whims and fancies. Whereas these organization where we had the leaders who are bound to work with what do I call it as emotional bonding. And that emotional bonding, along with built-in leadership qualities, are the basic reason for the success of ISRO. Actually, if you look at Professor Dhawan, it's not only the long hours we used to spend in ISRO. That is incidental. It's not, you can't go out. You have started something, you will live there. In fact, I remember very well, once we were together in the flight from Bombay to USA, the flight is Annapurna, and Dr. Sarabhai, who was sitting in the front first class compartment, came down and then sat with me in the economy class all through. And one sentence he made, very visibly is that he said, I am neither a good husband nor a good father. I don't think that anybody has published this so far. I have borrowed this statement to put in my book. He meant that he spends more time in flights and in offices and not in his residence. So the success lies that they are emotionally bonded to the project. That is the whole thing behind it. Now, Professor Dhawan used to say, I'm not going to filter out and then say that this is the quality, but I'm trying to tell you, for example, when we were configuring after SLV-3, we were talking about ASLV, and then PSLV, and then GSLV. I think don't get confused by the name SLV. SLV-3 means simple satellite launch vehicle, and P stands for polar, and G stands for geosynchronous. So in the augmentation vehicles, what he used to take care of, for example, we were configuring the PSLV. Now, Professor Dhawan said, or even GSLV, he said that the upper stage motor should be compatible. At that time, a very interesting phenomena was followed by ISRO. We didn't have anything on the rockets. We didn't have neither ammonium perchlorate nor unsymmetrical dimethyl hydrazine, which is used for the liquid, or nitrogen tetroxide, which is nothing. In fact, as somebody puts it, while I was interested in starting the liquid propulsion, a very senior person told me that liquid is only in Kaveri. Okay, and that was the situation. At that time, imagine the audacity or the guts of these people. Nothing is available, but then we were planning for satellites. Who will carry your satellites? Then Dhawan said, somebody else will carry till we are getting ready with our own satellite launch vehicles. All the INSAT series were actually launched by the NASA's launches, and then subsequently by the European Space Agency's launches, and then eventually by India. See, by the time we were learning what to do with our launches, we have already become experts on satellites. INSAT-2 and all the INSAT series, remote sensing, all kinds of satellites you talk about, we are second to none in the world as far as the satellite technology goes. Now, naturally, the credit goes to those leaders. See, the leaders didn't wait till such time that we become experts on launch vehicles. Now, coming back to the launch vehicles, the most interesting part is, it so happened, Kalam was very much interested in the solid rockets. And I should say that he was so devoted, dedicated, then he said that it is his life's mission, etc. But somehow, I felt that I should do something on the liquid propulsion systems. And so I wanted to start something, but you know, so we decided that let him go with his solid and let me try on my liquid. But on the liquid side, as I told you, we had nothing. The only fuel and oxidizer we had was aniline and nitric acid, the lowest specific impulse which you can imagine. Actually, liquid systems you prefer purely because of its high energy content. I am trying to use the words very cautiously here, assuming that most of you may be aware of or may not be aware of the terminology used by me in rocketry. But anyway, the energy level or the what you call energy index is known in rocketry as specific impulse. Now, the higher specific impulse is the key for going for liquid. And then same argument holds good for cryogenic. The order of magnitude of a solid rocket is in the range of about 220-230, the number. With the liquid, it will go to 290. And with cryogenic, it go to 460. Now, higher the energy index, the lesser is the weight you have to use. That means you can have a higher payload. This is the whole philosophy behind it. But we were going back Nitric acid aniline had a specific impulse of 180 compared to that of solid. So that was the starting point. And that also we have to borrow from somebody. We didn't have in the open market. And we practically burned our fingers in the aniline nitric acid combination. Series of failures. Contrary to series of successes in PSLV, we had series of failures. Then we used like a joke. What was the failure today? Was it the head end or the nozzle end? Or was it an explosion or was it just a puff? But then we started seeing fire and then we grew up. Today, our liquid systems have reached a stage, including the cryogenic. I should say that with proud, that the international standard as far as the cryogenic propulsion goes, the index which I was referring to is in the level of 430 seconds, 430, okay, I'm not using the word second, as though the unit is seconds, 430. Now, we were trying to have an agreement with the Russians for a cryogenic system where the specific impulse is in the range of 460. Americans, the topmost is 430, 35, 33 or something like that. In fact, suppose if that contract would have gone through, we would have got the specific impulse or the energy level will be in the range of 460. Now, but we have certainly today a better cryogenic system compared to that of the Americans, but inferior to that of the Russians. But still, you can certainly feel happy about it because you must remember the starting point wherein we started with 170 seconds of nitric acid and aniline. So Dr. Sarabhai's own method, which I understand from literature, you see, honestly, I didn't spend much of time in learning project management per se. I was spending more time on chemical rocket propulsion and Professor Croco's theorem of instability and then trying to understand the mathematical part of it. The combustion itself is complication and instability on that is much more complicated. So we were trying to break our head in understanding that. So we didn't have much time to learn project management per se. But Dr. Sarabhai, when he started, I don't know for sure, is it because of his ignorance in the rocketry or is it purposeful? But what he did was, he brought in specialists from all over the world, Indians. Heat transfer, combustion, structures, and then aerodynamics, control guidance, you know, all kinds of fields, all PhDs from foreign countries. And they were coming to India and they were trying to, no job definition was given to them. Sarabhai said, we are interested in rocketry, do something, whatever you can. So there was, in my opinion, a practical chaos. After some time, after 6 months or 1 year, Sarabhai brought in a French specialist by name Blamont. He was considered to be an expert in management. Like you guys are experts in management and management techniques. So he came and listened and he was allowed to speak to almost all the PhDs who were sitting in ISRO. And he spent about 2-3 weeks. And then at the end of the day, he came and then presented his findings. And the first thing which he presented, which I remember very well, I was a small guy, but it was very interesting. He went to the board and then drew a rectangle and then said, Dr. Sarabhai, this is the box. You please put your fellow specialist in this box and make sure they don't come out of this box. They only work within that box. And I'm communicating to you what was the kind of work going on at that time. Now, So the first lesson which I understood from the management technique is, you, what was Sarabhai didn't do? You define a project. Of course, later I added on with cost and timeline, and give him all the facilities and make sure that he delivers it. And don't allow him to do all other kinds of things which are unnecessary and not required for him. So this is one thing which I learned from Dr. Sarabhai's own way of doing it. But of course, Dr. Sarabhai was telling me later in an occasion that he was purposely trying to see whether these people will evolve something on their own. And he was to reorganize and restructure the whole thing after 71, but unfortunately he didn't live through. That job was carried over by Dr. Dhawan, Seshan, and Dr. Brahm Prakash. And Mr. Seshan was associated with us. Most of you must be knowing Seshan as a great, intelligent administrator associated with our election commission. But he is a great administrator and organizer as far as I am concerned in ISRO. He was in ISRO for more than 10 years, and he had contributed in the management side with respect to the Vikram Sarabhai Space Center. What he did, very interestingly, is that he restructured the whole thing. He implemented what Blumond was telling, that made sure that people doesn't do jobs which are not related to them, and then gave a definition of job to each individual. Of course, certainly with the blessings of with the blessings of Dr. Dhawan. Now, continuing in my own story of the Viking engine, I tried with aniline a 600 kg thrust. Finally, we managed to make the engine well, but then I flew it also. Imagine a 600 kg thrust. I am sure that you will understand a 600 kg. Compared to what is today's PSLV second stage is 60 tons. That is the kind of thrust level difference. Now, a 600 kg was the first one we flew, and then second one we tried to flew was a 3-ton engine. And then I felt that making a bigger rocket is easier than making a smaller rocket, or vice versa. Making a smaller rocket is very difficult. So we went for a 60-tonner as a joint development in collaboration with the French. And we certainly got stationed in France for more than, and the total period was something like 100 man years. So we had our own engineers working there, and their hands-on experience and understanding the whole technology. Now today, if you really look at it, the absorption of the technology in this method was so great. That is the reason why we have a highly reliable Vikas engine. Incidentally, you may like to know French Viking, I have named it as Vikas. Purely, I think I have not revealed that name so far, but I am just, not so far, I have done it in my book. But now I am making it clear that it was Vikram A. Sarabhai's short name. I made it as Vikas. And to others, I told that Vikas means development. Now, in the Vikas engine development, we learned something very interesting. It was supposed to be a know-how transfer. Actually, I understood in no time that the know-how transfer means nothing. In the know-how transfer, you are not going to be allowed to change even a bolt or a tightening torque. So what we planned was a know-why project, which is within the know-how project. Now the know-why project is the one which has yielded these required results. It can tell you in a way why this is a successful project, why some other projects are not success. I don't want to name those some other projects, and why they are not successful. Of course, I am not going to touch upon the Kaveri or the Vijayanti tankers and those will take us a long time. Now I have only 6 more minutes before that I have to complete it. Now the Vaijayanti and the Kaveri are our own designs, but we had it is something like this, you know, you take on a project and you lack the definition, you keep changing the configuration, and user requirement changes. So finally, above all, the leadership vanishes. There is no leadership. And then even if there is a leader, he is not emotionally bonded. So what happens? You can't have Sridharan's, who is known as Metro Man, and Kalam, who is known as a missile man, in all our projects. These are the people who are emotionally bonded. And that tells upon their success. Now, in the Viking engine, we have totally absorbed the technology, and we are successful in that. Now, I want to just tell some 2-3 incidents. In rocketry, we have a ground rule which says that we should not fly anything which was not tested on the ground. You cannot fly. Before flying, it should have been tested on the ground. So I came across a situation where the situation was very dicey. We had a second stage nozzle, which is the Viking engine nozzle, which is called a high altitude nozzle. Now this nozzle, if you have to follow the rule, you have to test it in the ground under high altitude condition, because the second stage ignites under high altitude. Honestly, I knew this, I knew the rule, I knew what is involved in it, but I was afraid of talking loud about it, because that could be the reason to cut the entire project down, because the cost of a high altitude facility was 100 crores and the time going to be taken was about 3 years. So internally in my mind, I made up my mind saying that let us cross the bridge when it comes. So everything went through. Finally, when we were talking about the flight, somebody who was intelligent, he raised this point that you should do the high altitude test. I said yes, at the cost of 100 crores and 3 years. So then they said, you knew it in advance. I said, maybe I knew it or I may not know it. But the point is, you have two options. One is you do the test and spend 3 years, or all of a sudden, which was already more or less like a prepared answer, I made a statement, why don't you consider the first flight itself is a ground test? And you know, it was a forced circumstances. And Professor Dhawan and Rao smiled lawfully, I mean happily. But they said, whatever it is, we have no option, so we will go ahead. And we went ahead. Incidentally, that was a successful test. And we never. But you must remember that it was more or less breaking a rule. But all the, you see, what is your aim as a project manager? Your aim is to deliver a product within the time frame and the cost. And you can't say that I won't take any risk whatsoever. If it's necessary, you have to take a calculated risk. Then Kalam asked me, supposing if it would have been a failure, what you would have done? I said, out, I would have gone out. What else to do? There is no other way of doing it. Similar thing I applied in the Mahendragiri. Mahendragiri, incidentally, is a place where we had the test facility set up for testing all the liquid rockets. See, in most of our other projects, if you take the railways, if you take the canal, if you take water linking, in all those areas, one thing which bothers you or bothers anybody is the land acquisition. And you are not able to acquire the land within the time frame, and you are not able to get the job. That's the reason why many of the projects are delayed. So here, what I did was that about 600 acres of land to be acquired. The only way I felt was that after giving them directly, a technocrat doesn't go and talk to the land acquisition is left to the revenue officials generally. And the revenue officials follow rules verbatim. And the result is, you know. So what I did was, I talked to them, took the pain of talking to them, explaining how great the organization will bring them some rosy things, which are true. But I went through a survey which made me to know that the cost of land is X rupees. I don't remember the value now. That's the highest cost. I simply offered that we will give you twice that cost. Now, you people should not make any legal problems. You should surrender the land and then go. I think the magic worked, excepting for one person. But then when I went and told the chairman, I said, sir, I made this comment. You may respect it or you may overrule me. But the point I am making is, if you don't, then the time will overrun so many years, and the cost which I am offering will be certainly, you will find it cheaper. In both cases, it worked well. So I only would like to conclude that when the Viking engine was developed, it was not just as rosy as you think. The leader, namely Professor Dhawan, knew that it is required, and he gave all the support, in spite of the fact the common man in ISRO was not in favor of that, or they didn't have confidence in it. So first step was, we had a collaboration. Second step was, we made a model at the cost of 5-10 lakhs. Then we made an actual working model at the cost of about 50 lakhs. And then I exhibited it in the foyer where every day everybody crosses it. And I put, my name is Vikas, my specific impulse is so much, my thrust is so much, etc. At the end I added, I am an orphan. And that worked, because I find Professor Dhawan is not able to accept the fact that here is a fellow, I mean, sort of. So he gave me the money to go abroad and then test it, because test facilities were not there. So we tested it abroad, not for 140 seconds, even for only 80 seconds, an outstretched time limit. And even the French were aghast, because our engine's performance was better than theirs. In fact, it will be a news to you, the stability margin, which is one of the factors considered in accepting a rocket, our stability margin is higher than that of theirs. And most interestingly, this design, namely a modification in the RFI sizes, were adopted by them later in their flights. So what I'm trying to say is that we have the potential and we have the willpower. Now, the successful projects always have a good leader, and the leader is emotionally bonded to the situation. And if he has a longer tenure, then he will be able to live through and then see the results. Now, I think the time limit is over, but just one small decision making, a wrong decision about ISRO, I'll touch upon. When I was trying to make the test facilities, I was trying to impress the chairman, saying that we should do it for the four-engine configuration. What do I mean by four-engine is, a single engine can be tested in one in test facility. I wanted to make it as a four-engine configuration, meaning that you can cluster four engines and then test it, meaning that the test facility will be having a higher capacity, meaning that the cost will go up by about 1 crore or so more. But he didn't agree to that. He said, let us learn to stand and then walk. Afterwards, let us run. But what happened when we successfully developed, when we were talking about GSLV options, a four-engine configuration would have been an excellent option. But a wrong decision has, if that decision were in our favor, we would have got a different configuration of GSLV, which is not going to be the one which is flying now. So what I'm trying to say is, decisions are to be made, right decisions are to be made, and that should be made by a leader, and that leader should possess not only the leadership qualities, but also should have an emotional bonding to the decisions which he is making. For that, he should have enough time. And if this is achieved, every project in ISRO in India will be a success. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for the inspiring keynote speech. Your experience is a teaching to us. As a token of appreciation, we would like to present you a memento and a spot even photograph in memory of the conference. May I request Mr. Raj Kaladi, Managing Director, PMI India, to do the honor.